Good morning and welcome to Grace Church. So happy to have you here as we worship the risen Christ. I say to you confidently, He is risen. He is risen indeed. And it's a delight to, as we have entered into the resurrection season, it is a season and it's an everyday reality and it's a weekly reality. And we ought not to deny or diminish any of those. But we worship here today on the first day of the week because our Savior, our Lord, our King is risen. Death has been defeated. Our salvation is secured. And that ought to change the way we live. And so let's do that today. By way of announcement, grab your bulletins. If you don't have one, they're just outside the door as you're walking out on your left. Just a couple of announcements. After the morning service, we will have our CE hour after a 15-20 minute break, and we are finishing up our study of bibliology, and then we'll be discussing the authority of Scripture over our worship. So please stick around and join us for that conversation. It'll be a good delight to have you. Wednesday night is prayer meeting, 6:30 to 7:30. Love to have you here with us. We are needy people. We need grace and mercy, and that is why the throne of grace is there, or at least one of its blessings is to come before it and ask our God for grace and mercy. So, and then thirdly, in terms of announcements, next Saturday, a week from yesterday, is Chris Ames' ordination over in Boyceville, Wisconsin. Chris is a former member here at our church and has been pastoring over in Wisconsin for the last 4 years, and he's being ordained. And so if you would like to go over for that, it's an early Saturday morning. We'll probably leave here about 6:15 in the morning and then head over there to Boyceville. Let Kristen and I know today if you haven't, so we can let the church know they're providing lunch, and so we need to get them a number of people who are coming. So let us know today if you are planning on coming with us. You're welcome to ride with us or drive yourself over. That should do it for our announcements. So again, if you don't have a bulletin, just slip out and grab one quickly. We will use it in our worship today. For our call to worship, open your Bibles, if you would, to Proverbs chapter 30. Proverbs chapter 30, it's right near the middle of your Bible. And if you're using the Pew Bible in front of you, it's page 551. 551, Proverbs chapter 30. And I'm simply going to read verse 4 and 5. Proverbs 30, verse 4 and 5. Who has ascended to heaven and come down? Who has gathered the wind in his fists? Who has wrapped up the waters in a garment? Who has established all the ends of the earth? What is his name? And what is his son's name? Surely you know. Every word of God proves true. He is a shield to those who take refuge in Him. This is the God that we worship today. The God who has all power and all control over every bit of His creation. I think it was Dr. McCune who said, "There is not one rogue atom in the universe." God sovereignly controls each one. But not only is He awesome in His power, He is right and true in all of His ways. Every word of God proves true. He speaks truth. He is truth. What He tells us is truth. And we ought to listen and heed Him. And finally, He is the God in which you can trust. Because of His power, because of His goodness, and because of many more things not listed in this text, you can trust Him. Look at verse 5. He is a shield to those who take refuge in Him. This is the God whom you must worship. A God of this magnitude, this infinity, is not a God that we can come and worship with half our heart or even 90%. There's no command in Scripture, love the Lord your God with 90% of your heart, with 90% of your mind, with 90% of your strength. He requires it all, and He is worthy of it all. And this great God, this awesome God, has invited you and I to come to him in worship today. And that is our privilege. So let's do that in Jesus' name. Let me pray before we begin, and then we will sing praises to our great God. Heavenly Father, you are an amazing God. You are worthy of the highest praise and devotion that we can give. We'll never worship you enough. We will never worship you sufficiently so that we can stop. Father, your praise deserves to be proclaimed by every creature and every human heart. And that's not the case right now. And we long for the day when it will be, when your kingdom will be established and every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is the Christ, to the glory of God the Father. Until that happens, Father, may our hearts be ever moldable, ever submissive to your word, to your kingship, to your spirit, in gratitude for the work of your Son. Father, receive our worship now from pure hearts. Help us to forsake whatever sin is there. Father, if it's there and we know it, we confess it now and seek a clean slate to worship you purely. Father, receive our worship, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. For our first hymn, actually, we're going to take your insert out of here. This is a former hymn of the month. The music is on page 214, or hymn number 214. But all of the verses we're going to sing are right here on your insert, of the Father's love begotten. So you may turn to 214 if you'd like and stick your insert in there with you. Stand with me, please, to hymn number 214.
Of the things that are that bad.
Amen, amen. All right, take your hymn books, turn to hymn number 116, and you can just flip your insert over. Actually, I put the verses on there because we have a couple of extra ones. So the music is on hymn number 116, Rejoice, the Lord is King, and we'll sing all the verses on your insert. Hymn number 116, Rejoice, the Lord is King. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. At this time, we will take our morning offering. And just so you know, the ushers will hold on to the plates. If you'd like to put something in, you're welcome to do that. If you're not comfortable, there's an offering box in the back. And know that this is a member-supported missionary ministry. So if you're visiting with us, you have no obligation. No expectation to put anything in. I do want to correct one thing. I apologize. We have the first three verses in our hymnal of this song, and they're rather standard verses. And so I thought, well, I'll just copy them for ease so it's all on one sheet so we don't have to go back and forth between the hymnal. And apparently I copied the wrong websites. Damn, I've never seen on verse 3, second line, the keys of earth and hell are to our Jesus given. I sang death and hell, and I heard all you sing death and hell, and I'm glad, okay? We're here to celebrate the resurrection of Christ, okay? Yes, he will conquer earth, but we are celebrating that he has conquered death and hell. So I apologize for that typo there. Let us pray. Gracious Father, you are our good God. You have given us everything, life and all of the blessings that come with it. And Father, more than that, you have given us your Son. We have salvation because of him, because of his death and burial and resurrection. So, Father, we worship you, we praise you, we thank you, and we submit ourselves to you. We give now, not as any type of repayment, but simply to express our gratitude and to be obedient to your commands, that we would give of our means to see the gospel spread here in Otsego and around the world. Father, thank you for your lavish gift to us. We ask that you'll bless these funds and use them, and we would be good stewards with them. And we pray that the gospel would spread. We pray that more people would bow the knee to your great Son and to your holy name. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take your Bibles, please, and turn to Genesis chapter 1. Book of Genesis, the very first book of Scripture, chapter 1. We're going to be doing some things a little bit different and just simply reading Scripture through from one service to another. And a good place to start is at the beginning. I've always liked verse 1. Before I begin to read, it says, "In the beginning, God." That's a good phrase to keep in your head every day, all day. And you wake up in the morning, in the beginning of my day, God. And helps you challenge a little bit. All right, Genesis chapter 1, please follow as I read. "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, 'Let there be light.' And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, 'Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters.' And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening and there was morning, the second day. And God said, 'Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear.' And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas, and God saw that it was good. And God said, 'Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit in which there is seed, each according to its kind on the earth.' And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good, and there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good, and there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. We'll be stopping at that point for this morning and picking up next week. All right, take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1. I had a feeling Pastor wanted me to read this because he's going to tease me when I get all done. I got to pronounce every word, every name correctly. Trouble is, I'm the only one who knows what's correct. You don't, ha ha. All right, you're in Matthew chapter 1. As we get into this, it is a genealogy of Jesus Christ, beginning from Abraham to King David to the birth of Christ. If you pay attention, it's actually a history stretch with names. And those names, if you pay attention and go back and study your Old Testament, you'll learn different things about all these people. And it's kind of an interesting study. Also notice as I read, there's little historical references that kind of help link the chain. And I even mention a few places where major sin had occurred. So it's just an interesting portion of Scripture. All right. Verse 1, Matthew chapter 1. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, and Judah the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar, and Perez the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Ram, and Ram the father of Abinadab, and Abinadab the father of Nahshon, and Nahshon the father of Salmon, and Salmon the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of David the king. And David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah, and Solomon the father of Rehoboam, and Rehoboam the father of Abijah, and Abijah the father of Asaph, and Asaph the father of Jehoshaphat, and Jehoshaphat the father of Joram, and Joram the father of Uzziah, and Uzziah the father of Jotham, and Jotham the father of Ahaz, and Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, and Hezekiah the father of Manasseh, and Manasseh the father of Amos, Amos the father of Josiah, and Josiah the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. And after the deportation to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, and Shealtiel the father of Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel the father of Abihud, and Abihud the father of of Eliakim, and Eliakim the father of Azor, and Azor the father of Zadok, and Zadok the father of Akim, and Akim the father of Eliahud, and Eliahud the father of Eleazar, and Eleazar the father of Matthan, and Matthan the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called Christ. So, all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations. And from David to deportation to Babylon, 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon, the Christ, and to the Christ, 14 generations. May God give us understanding of all we just read.
Thank you, Don. There's about 6 good sermons in that genealogy, okay? Including the defense of the virgin birth. We'll get to that at some point. But thank you, Brother Don, for reading that. Take your hymnals, please. Turn to hymn number 17. You may remain seated for this one. Hymn number 17, O Father, You Are Sovereign. We'll sing all 4 verses here. Amen. Now for our scripture reading for the passage today. If you take your Bibles, please, and turn to John chapter 12. John chapter 12, verses 36 through 50. It's also on page 899 in your pew Bibles, if you're using that. John chapter 12, verse 36 through 50. We'll actually start in the middle of the verse. Would you stand, please, when you've found it, as we honor God and His Word. John 12, 36, the second half, through the end of the chapter, verse 50. When Jesus had said these things, He departed and hid Himself from them. Though He had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in Him, so that the words spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Lord, who has believed what he heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore they could not believe. For again Isaiah said, He has blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, lest they see with their eyes and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. Isaiah said these things because he saw His glory and spoke of Him. Nevertheless, many, even of the authorities, believed in Him. But for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it, so that they would not be put out of the synagogue. For they loved the glory that comes from man more than the glory that comes from God. And Jesus cried out and said, Whoever believes in me, believes not in me, but in Him who sent me. And whoever sees me, sees Him who sent me. I have come into the world as light, so that whoever believes in me may not remain in darkness. If anyone hears my words and does not keep them, I do not judge him. For I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. The one who rejects me and does not receive my words has a judge. The word that I have spoken will judge him on the last day. For I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me has himself given me a commandment, what to say and what to speak. And I know that his commandment is eternal life. What I say, therefore, I say as the Father has told me. The word of the Lord. Thank you. You may be seated. How many of you are heart surgeons by learning or trade? None? Okay, good. I'm in the same boat with you. How many of you have studied brain surgery? Anybody performed any? I don't mean psychological brain surgery on your children, okay? No. That's what I thought, and I'm right there with you. I'm guessing no one here would feel confident lecturing a group of brain surgeons on a particular aneurysm procedure, right? That is above us. It's not above human understanding, praise the Lord. And when we or a loved one has a heart attack or a brain attack, as we call aneurysms, we're thankful for medical personnel who have studied, who have the ability, who have the knowledge, who understand and can help us. But we acknowledge there are parts that tap the limit of human thinking and understanding. But if you think that is daunting, try understanding the depth and infinity of the character of God and the wisdom of all his ways. We have sung and celebrated the sovereignty of God, as rightly we should, because Scripture affirms it. One book I read, it said, if you look for it, if you're looking, the sovereignty of God is on every page of Scripture. And I said to the author out loud, I said, well, I'm with you on the sovereignty of God, but you might be exaggerating just a little bit there. But I think I've mentioned before, Pastor Hitz and I at Blaine Baptist Church went through a few books of the Bible looking for every reference to the sovereignty of God. And in Exodus alone, we found 1,189. I remember there was one chapter, I can't remember if it was 12 or 13, there's 12 verses in the whole chapter, we found 20 references. It's all over. And in many ways, this is mysterious to us. Many facets of his character, many instances of his providence confound us. We often ask the question, why? And there's a right way and a wrong way to ask why. The right way is to acknowledge, God, I am finite. You are infinite. Help me understand. We are not allowed to ask why as a critique. If we do, then God is perfectly just in asking us how well we have done managing the earth that he has made. If you want to know how well you're doing, there's 88 questions listed in the last four chapters of Job to see how good you and I are doing managing the universe. The answer is not good. We don't have the right, the prerogative to question the wisdom and counsel of God. But we can ask for understanding. And John is going to deal with some difficult aspects of the Father's work in our text today, the end here of chapter 12. Now, you may or may not be able to fully comprehend what God is doing and why, even in our text today. But as John will show you, you must believe in the one who sent Christ. You must believe in the one who sent Christ. I think our text answers the question why and gives us three reasons. Number one, because he sovereignly elects. Because he sovereignly elects. Number two, because he savingly glorifies. Number two, because he savingly glorifies. And the third reason, you must believe in the one who sent Christ. is because he severely judges. He severely judges. And we'll look at each of these reasons in turn today. So number one here in our text, he sovereignly elects. Just to set the context, as we have been wont to do, we are in the last week of Jesus' life. We're probably on Tuesday evening. He came in on Palm Sunday. He presented himself publicly as their Messiah, fulfilling prophecy. He came in, as Zechariah prophesied, on a donkey. The people responded in the text of Psalm 118, how you respond to the Messiah. You shout, Hosanna, Hosanna, which means save us now. Be our king. Rescue us. And they did. And then for the next 2 days, he goes in Monday. He cleanses the temple for the second time. And he takes up authority and position there. He rules from the temple also as Zechariah prophesied Messiah would. And so he rules, he governs in the most, and presents himself in the most messianic, visibly way possible he has his entire 3.5 years. He knows the end is this week, as we're addressing. Friday morning, he is going to be condemned by the Sanhedrin and then by the people of Israel, and will be on a cross by noon on Friday. And so, as he has been going out throughout Israel for 3.5 years, presenting himself, as John says, as their Messiah, the Christ, and as God come in the flesh, the Son of God, and calling all to repent and to believe in him, in his claims, he is going to make his final appeal these 2 days. All of his enemies are going to come and challenge him publicly. And John does not deal with the vast majority, really, with any of these. Matthew, Mark, and Luke talk about all of these encounters, and I encourage you to read through their chapters on Monday and Tuesday of the Passion Week. John gives us the summary Tuesday evening before he leaves town for the last time under his own freedom and purposes. And so here we are, Tuesday evening. He has defeated all of his enemies, and he has laid before the people of Israel a choice. You will trust in the works righteousness of the Pharisees that they have presented, that they demand of you, or you will trust in me to save you from your sins and to be your righteousness. And we come now to the end of the matter. John has recorded these 7 signs, these 7 miracles, each of which would show and demonstrate him to be the Christ, the Messiah, and the Son of God. And now they have a decision to make. They're going to render their verdict Friday morning. But he has given them time to consider. And John tells us ahead of time, really gives us a sneak peek as to what that will be. And we see in here the sovereign election of God. Look at verse 37. Though he had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him. He has done so many signs. John just records these 7. And at the end of the book, when he gives us the purpose of the book, he says, Jesus did many other signs that are not recorded in this book. He says in chapter 21, Jesus did so many signs that if all of them were written down, I love this phrase, the world would not have room for the books that could be written. There's at least 2 times in Luke, and I think it's Matthew, where it says Jesus healed all who came to him. Well into the night, person after person lines up. He heals. The next one comes. He heals. He heals. He heals. He's just healing people all over the place. Jesus did so many signs to demonstrate that he was who he said he was. And the conclusion is, on the whole, despite some exceptions, he had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him. So that the word of the spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Lord, who has believed what he heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He sovereignly elects those who will believe. He sovereignly appoints those who do not. Look at verse 39. Therefore, they could not believe. For again, Isaiah said, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, lest they see with their eyes and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. We see and hear the sovereign prerogative of God in saving souls. God is the one who sovereignly elects and chooses souls to salvation. Why? We don't know entirely. At minimum, we know so that it will succeed. If God starts a work, God finishes the work. How many of you have started a project and not finished it? Or am I the only incompleter here? How many of you have fully intended to complete the work and not completed it? How many of us have overestimated our ability to finish the work? Oh, I can handle this. Yeah, I can. Yeah, this isn't rocket science. It's not brain surgery. I can fix this engine by myself. Okay, there's a couple in here who probably could. I am not one of them. But we are people who need approximately 7 to 8 hours of sleep every night, or we're not functional. We are people who need air at least every 3 minutes or so just to stay alive. We need water at least every 3 days or we die. We need food at least every 3 weeks, or some of us 4 weeks or 5 weeks, or we die. We are limited, we are finite, and worse than that, we're fallen. We're sinners. And all the effects of sin and the curse are upon us. We could not save ourselves, and we would not save ourselves apart from the grace of God. God has to do the work from start to finish. But understand that His sovereignty never mitigates human responsibility. It never excuses human responsibility. I've said this before, God's sovereignty is not an excuse to apathy on our part. And God's sovereignty is not a reliever of our responsibilities. These two work hand in hand. Mysteriously, yes. And it's okay if you don't fully understand all the ways in which the sovereignty of God and the responsibility of man relate. Just know that they do. And you must believe in that. Think of Joseph in the Old Testament. Remember him? 11th of 12 sons, and certainly not the favorite child. He was the favorite of his dad. He was not the favorite of his brothers. Okay? And so finally his older 10 brothers have had enough. And they see him coming. They're away. They're alone. Dad's not around to watch and protect. No one can stop us. Let's kill him. And with murderous intent, they physically assault him. And then, whether then or later, think better of it. But not because of any moral virtue of themselves, but because the Midianites came along. And they thought, hey, they buy live slaves, not dead ones. So they sell him and make a profit. Even better. Our problem is gone and we're richer for it. And Joseph is abandoned from his family for the next 13 years. He's treated more and more unjustly throughout the course of those events. And at no point do his brothers ever say, that probably wasn't the best thing we ever did. Let's see if we can go down to Egypt and get him back. Let's repent. Okay, we did wrong. Let's go and try to correct it. Maybe Joseph is still alive. Not once. They leave him there. Until they come, hats in hand, beggars, before the Pharaoh of Egypt, asking for grain to stay alive, and not realizing that the vice pharaoh standing in front of him in charge of all of this, life-giving grain, is their brother Joseph himself. And when they interact with him, when he finally reveals himself, listen to what he says. This is Genesis 45. So Joseph said to his brothers, come near to me, please. And they came near. And he said, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in these land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord over all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. And I assure you, brothers and sisters, Joseph is not schizophrenic. He's not bipolar. He just said, do not be distressed or angry because you sold me here. Verse 8, so it was not you who sent me here, but God. God's sovereignty, human responsibility, working out exactly the way God wanted. And that doesn't justify for one moment the hatred, the murderous intent, the unrighteous selling of him, and all the subsequent evil done by their negligence to bring Joseph to this point. But as he will say in chapter 50, at the end of the book, there was dual intention. You meant this for evil. God meant this for good. There are always two intentions, God's and ours. And you are not responsible for God's intentions and God's actions. You are responsible for your own. The sovereignty of God never mitigates human responsibility. Yes, it is true that everything that happens is under the sovereignty of God. And yes, it is true, you are guilty for every sin which you commit, and you alone will bear the consequence of it. Or the guilt of it, I should say. Sadly, the consequences spill beyond us sometimes. But his sovereignty never mitigates human responsibility. His sovereignty also never limits itself. Look at verse 39 and 40. Therefore they could not believe, for again, Isaiah said, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, lest they see with their eyes and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. God never paints himself into a corner, as it will. God's sovereignty enables him to fulfill his word. Verse 38 says, this happened so that the word spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. All fulfilled prophecy is due to the sovereignty of God. God can say the Messiah will be born in Bethlehem because he is in control of human events, including causing Caesar to call for a census, even though Joseph is up in Nazareth where the jobs are and the money is. But because God said that the Messiah will be born in Bethlehem, he orchestrates the events of human history to bring that about. Caesar Augustus did not sit up and say, you know what, I've been reading Micah a little bit, and we got to get Jesus down, we got to get Joseph down to Bethlehem, okay, and Mary. That was the least of his concern. I can safely and confidently say it never crossed his mind. He said, hey, the budget's looking a little low, let's raise the taxes, okay? But God is sovereignly working. All fulfilled promises of God are due to his sovereignty. When God brings about the things which he promises, it's because he is in absolute control. Have you ever promised something to someone and not been able to fulfill the promise? Yes. Honey, I'll be home at 5 o'clock. Okay? That doesn't always happen. But God is able to fulfill all of his promises. He said to Abraham, your descendants will go down to Egypt. They will be slaves for 400 years, and then I will bring them out. And when God sent Moses back to Egypt, the most least likely redeemer, the most least likely deliverer to the people who had been enslaved for nearly four centuries, to the most powerful army on earth at the time, it looked absolutely impossible that any Jewish slave would be rescued from Egypt. And yet, months later, with Egypt devastated and Israel enriched, 3 million plus slaves walked to freedom. God is able to fulfill his promises due to his sovereignty. He also answers prayer due to his sovereignty. People have often asked the question, if God is sovereign, why should I pray? If he's working it all out, why do I have to pray and ask him for anything? Let me turn the question around. If he is not sovereign, why would you pray? What are you going to ask him to do? Think about the farmer who does not believe that God is sovereign over the weather events. And he needs rain. What can he say? God, I know that you have nothing to do in the causing of rain. And you and I both know how desperately I need rain. So would you sit up there and just wish along with me that the rain would somehow happen? Now, you know I'm being sarcastic. If I were serious, that would be blasphemous. Or what about the salvation of souls? How would you pray to God if he were not sovereign over the saving of souls? God, I know that you can do nothing to draw this person to yourself. I know that you cannot open blind eyes. And so you know how desperately I love my mother, my brother, my son, my daughter, my spouse, my neighbor, my coworker. And Father, would you sit along up there and hope that somehow of their glorious free will they'll turn from sin and love you? That won't happen. We pray to God because he is sovereign over rain, over salvation, and everything in between. His sovereignty determines the outcome of all things, including our belief. And, as I said before, it's compatible with human responsibility. There is much that could be said about this, but as I pointed out with Joseph, God's sovereignty and human responsibility mesh together just fine. If you need another example, you can look it up on your own. Look up 2 Corinthians 8:16-17. 2 Corinthians 8:16-17, and see how and why Titus loves the Corinthians. All right? We'll skip it for the sake of time. We can address it in the CE hour if you'd like. But God's sovereignty never dishonors him. Look at verse 41. Isaiah said these things, that God hardened their hearts. He blinded their eyes, so they did not see or understand and turn and be healed. Isaiah said these things because he saw his glory and spoke of him. God's sovereignty never dishonors him. When God's glory is at stake, you can rest assured God will defend his glory. And God's glory is magnified, is exalted, is put on display gloriously. Consider just a few texts. Romans 11:36. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. Ephesians 1:11-12. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. Psalm 115:3. Our God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases. Think of the most mighty king over the most mighty one world government that has ever existed thus far, Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. At the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him who lives forever and ever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? Or Job after his 88 question inquisition. Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. If this is confusing to you, that's okay. You're human, you're finite, you're fallen, just like me. But it's not okay to ignore it, to not seek to understand God more. You must read God's word. You must meditate on it. Spend time pondering these passages. You must study his person and his ways. Husbands and wives, like you study each other when your marriage is strong. You want to know more about the person. You seek to know why they do what they do. We must study our God the same way. Thus, the first reason why you must believe in the one who sent Christ is that he sovereignly elects. The second reason is that he savingly glorifies. He savingly glorifies. In verse 42, it says, "Nevertheless, many, even of the authorities, believed in him, but for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it, so they would not be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the glory that comes from man more than the glory that comes from God." Brothers and sisters, there is a temporal kind of glory. It's temporary. It is short-lived. And the Pharisees owned it in that day. They were feared and revered. They were respected. The Pharisees ruled Israel's day-to-day life. So many of the details were dictated by the Pharisees. But you know when that came to an end? AD 70 at the latest. When Titus and his troops came from Rome and crushed and destroyed Israel and Jerusalem and the temple, the Pharisees' glory was gone. And also the Pharisees did not rule Israel's afterlife. The moment an Israel died, he was under the wrath or the grace of God. And the Pharisees did not have one say over it. Theirs was a temporal glory. Children, when your parents tell you to go and clean your room, there is a temporary joy that you can find in complaining. If you don't want to do it, there may be a temporary joy in disobeying and keep on doing what you want to do instead. But I promise you, happiness in your rebellion will not last. Once your parents discipline you, I assure you, the joy of sin is gone. And if your parents are particularly tired that day and they forget to discipline you, then know that God sees your rebellion. And he does not forget. It's not worth it, boys and girls. It's better to obey, even if you don't want to now, because God sees and God rewards. Teenagers, that eye roll might feel really good when your parents say something that you don't like. But that rebellion ends. The joy, excuse me, in that rebellion ends. Once you understand the love that they have for you, and if that you don't understand that, it ends when you stand before God and you have to give account for every careless word that comes out of your mouth, and every thought and deed is laid bare. Husband and wives, men and women, a man will have to give an account for every careless word that comes out of his lips. We must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ and give an account for how we have lived the lives, how we have spent the resources that he has given us. And brothers and sisters, they will be burned, and the fire will expose the quality. If it's wood, hay, and stubble, it's gone. If it's gold, silver, and precious jewels, it will endure. There's a temporal glory, but there is also an eternal glory. Verse 43 says, they love the glory that comes from man more than the glory that comes from God. John has told us much about God's glory. Consider, through this book thus far, chapter 1, verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. There is a gracious and true glory that is to be had in Jesus Christ. There is a grace exceeding grace kind of glory. Same chapter, verse 16. For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. There is a lasting glory that comes from knowing the grace of Jesus Christ. There's the seeing the invisible God glory. Chapter 1, verse 18. No one has ever seen God. The only God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known. When you gaze upon the person and work of Jesus Christ and consider him, it is a lasting glory. There's regenerative entrance into the kingdom of God kind of glory. Chapter 3, verse 3. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. There's a glory that lasts both now and to the kingdom and beyond. And there is everlasting life kind of glory. Chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. There is a glory that lasts forever and ever in life. And then 3:36, there is an aversion of God's wrath glory to be had. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. These Jews in our text today, you and I in life today, have two kinds of glory we can pursue. The temporal kind or the eternal kind. There's some that will be burned up, and there's glory that lasts forever. This is the glory that comes from God. You don't want to miss it. I don't care what you have in life. I don't care what you're pursuing. It will not compare to the glory of God that is ours in Christ. And finally, it's not just an eternal glory, it's a shared glory. Look at verse 44 through 46. Jesus cried out, "Whoever believes in me believes not in me, but in him who sent me. And whoever sees me sees him who sent me. I have come into the world as light, so that whoever believes in me may not remain in darkness." Jesus reveals the Father. He came here to reveal the Father. I read in chapter 1, verse 18, no one has seen God the Father, but the Son came to earth for this purpose, to reveal him to us, that we can see him and his glory. And it is life-changing. It is joy-giving. It is wrath-averting. Brothers and sisters, strive for it. He not only reveals the Father, he reveals the way to the Father. He is the light so that you will not be in darkness, that you'll know how to get to God. The more you seek the everlasting glory that is found in knowing the triune God, the more you will get it. The more you will cherish it. The more you will long for it. If holiness does not sound at all appealing to you, it is because you are not a holy person. If it sounds a little appealing, then know that you have work to do. But the holiness and happiness of God goes perfectly together. The more we know God and are shaped into his image, the happier we will be. The happiest person who ever lived was not Bill Gates. It was not John D. Rockefeller. It was not Alexander the Great, and I can assure you it was not even Nebuchadnezzar. The happiest person who ever lived is Jesus Christ, because he perfectly knew his Father. He perfectly obeyed his Father, and he made a way so that we can join him on that happy road. Brothers and sisters, follow him. Thus, the first reason that you must believe in the one who sent Christ is that he sovereignly elects. The second reason is that he savingly glorifies. And the third reason is that he severely judges. He severely judges. He says, "If anyone hears my words," verse 47, "and does not keep them, I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world." His judgment, therefore, we see here in verse 47, is staggered. Did Jesus have every right to judge the world when he came the first time? Yes, he did. He was perfectly holy and righteous. The world was perfectly sinful and guilty. the right thing to do. It would have been perfectly right to judge all mankind for their sin the moment he entered our world. Did he have the ability to do it? Absolutely he did. He was God in the flesh. He showed us glimpses of that ability, right? Calming the seas, walking the water, raising the dead, turning water into wine, etc., etc. He had absolute power to do it. But in his wisdom, mercy, and love, he has staggered it. He has delayed said judgment. But just because it delays, do not think that it is deterred. The judgment of God will fall on men for their sin and rebellion. But in God's limitless kindness, it fell on his Son. The wrath of God fell on Christ, and thus you and I can be saved. His judgment has been staggered. It has been delayed. But his judgment also is synthesized. Kids, synthesized just means to combine a number of different things into one coherent, makes sense whole. It fits together nicely. He says, I have not come to judge. It's his word that judges. In verses 49 and 50, he says, it's the Father who judges. In chapter 5, verse 22 and 27, he says, he himself judges. And we're not there yet, but in a few months, we'll be in chapter 16. And the Spirit there judges. It is a triune effort in judgment. It is a triune act, an accomplishment of judgment. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit, and his word that he has spoken will judge mankind. It will come. It is being delayed, but only for a little while. And we don't know for how long. Which is why the Apostle Paul can say, now is the day of salvation. Or the author of Hebrews, if you hear his voice today, do not harden your hearts as they did in the wilderness for 40 years. Today, repent and trust the one whom God the Father has sent. Thus, the first reason why you must believe in the one who sent Christ is that he sovereignly elects. The second reason is that he savingly glorifies, and the third reason is that he severely judges. So how do you do this? Well, first and foremost, believe the signs of Scripture and the message which they validate. Believe the message of John. Jesus is the Christ. He is the Messiah. He is God in the flesh. And only by believing in him will you have life in his name. He is the only one who can avert the wrath of God for your sins. And if you have not done that, I implore you today, believe and repent. Trust Christ to save you. If you have done that, then I challenge you, trust him completely. Trust him in all things. Start and end your day in prayer. And fill all the middle parts with prayer too. Or to say it as Paul said it, pray without ceasing. When we pray to God, we show our dependence on him. We ask him to do the things that only he can do. We show that we know we can't change ourselves. We need his mercy. We need his grace. We need his Spirit. When our affections and our desires aren't what they ought to be, we admit that we can't change them ourselves. God, give me a new heart. Give me a pure heart. Help me to love you as I ought, because I don't. And I can't put my fist to my forehead and make it happen by trying harder. I need your grace. Trusting him completely means rejoice in all things at all times, because he is sovereign over it all, big and small. Thirdly, worship Christ for his sovereign salvation. Worship him for it. Was it, I can't remember, I think it was the CER we talked about last week. But if you had the 2% determinant factor in your salvation, how much praise would you deserve for your salvation? 2%. If you did 10, you deserve 10. If you did 0, you deserve 0. If God accomplished your salvation, he deserves all the praise for it. So worship God for his sovereign salvation. And then fourth and finally, witness of his sovereign grace. Tell the lost about our Savior. Call them to repent, because he and he alone can save them. It's not your job. Don't worry about that part. Your job is to tell them. Your job is to be the hands and feet that bring the gospel, the good news, to those who have not yet repented. Do that and leave the outcome with Christ. Let's pray. Father, we are needy people of the highest and most infinite kind. We cannot save ourselves. We need your grace. And Father, having come to salvation, as many of us, most of us, I trust, have, not one of us can finish the sanctifying work by ourselves. Father, we need you. So, Father, help us to confess our need before you, to pray and seek your grace and mercy each and every day, to obey your commands that you give us so clearly, and to tell the watching world how great you are and why they must repent as well. Father, please bless these efforts and use them and many others to make us more like the image of your Son, so that you get all the glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we will celebrate, as we do once a month, the Lord's table. We'll wait on our deacons to come forward here. And as we do, if you would, turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where we have our most extensive and explicit instruction as we come to the table. It's page 958, if you're following in your pew Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. As we see, I'll start in verse 23. Paul says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given it, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" What we have here before us are crackers and juice. And when you consume them, they will still be crackers and juice. Nothing magical will happen. They won't turn into the body of Christ. They won't give you grace points with God. But they will and they must remind you of the price that Jesus paid for your sins. And if that's not true in your life, if you haven't trusted Christ to save you from your sins, I would ask you to refrain. And just think through what we have talked about today. Think through what I have just read. And think why you have not yet bowed the knee and repented and trusted Christ. These will do nothing to save you from your sins. They are simply for those who have already been saved, to remember the great cost that Christ spent on our behalf. Verse 25, he says, in the same way, he also took the cup after supper. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We are to remember the work that he has done. He then gives us a warning down at the end, in verse 29, or starting verse 28, where he tells us to examine. Let a person examine himself, and then so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. If you are not a follower of God, I'm not asking you to refrain because we don't have enough crackers and juice. I'm not asking you to refrain because we don't want to share with you. I'm asking you to refrain so you don't invite judgment down upon you. This is for those who have repented and trusted Christ. This is a unifying ordinance. This is for the church. So if you haven't joined a church, if you're not interested in joining a church, I'd ask you to refrain. If you're visiting and you're members of another church that preaches the gospel, you are welcome to participate with us. But we want to rightly discern the body of the Lord. And so that's what we will do together. Let me pray and thank God, and then we will participate. Gracious Father, holy God, you are right to judge our sins. And if you numbered our sins before you, who of us could stand? None. But by your grace and your mercy, you have judged sin in your Son. You've judged our sin for those of us who have trusted in you and repented. And so, Father, we celebrate you, your love. We celebrate your Son and his sacrifice. We celebrate the power of your Spirit, which raised him from the dead. Father, help us to be mindful of your Son and the cost which he spent for us, and help us to proclaim his death until he comes. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're about to participate, but before we do, when you participate, let all of your senses be involved. He said, "This is my body, which is for you." This little cracker is about to be crushed. It's going to be crushed by your teeth. His body was crushed because of your sins and mine. Do this in remembrance of him. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his shed blood. We thank you for his willingness to go all the way to the cross, to not stop before, even at the greatest cost to himself, and the severance of the sweet fellowship he had enjoyed with you for all eternity and has enjoyed since. Father, we worship you and we worship your Son. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, I ask you to involve all of your senses. If you look at this, it looks nice. You smell it, it smells nice. You put it in your mouth, it tastes nice. But everything about the death of Christ was completely the opposite. It was not nice at all. And it was because of you and me, our rebellion. And yet he suffers, and we get the blessing. Let's do this in remembrance of him. Please keep your cups together, and when you depart from here, there'll be trash cans out behind the corner in the bathrooms and around the corner. Paul says, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We've looked back, and now we look forward. He is coming, and that ought to fill our souls with joy and a hope that is indistinguishable. And when we finish celebrating the Lord's Supper, we take a deacon's offering here in our church. If you'd like to participate, this is just used to meet the needs within the body. So we will sing our closing hymn. The deacons will hold on to the plates, and you may participate if you like. Take your hymnals, if you would, please. And turn with me to hymn number 296. Hymn number 296, Hallelujah, What a Savior. And we'll sing this as our closing hymn together. Stand with me. Hymn number 296, Hallelujah, What a Savior. Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God.
To 14. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, believed in him and were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. Go in peace and witness boldly, knowing that your past sins, your present circumstances, and your future salvation are secured by Christ. You are dismissed. Children, come and show me your pictures and your notes, please.
You're first.